you had people saying, like, working for, you know, like a nonprofit that's funded by the government, right? They're going to Twitter and they're flagging content and they're saying, this is true, but it's being misinterpreted, right? So we don't want people to read this too frequently because it might inspire vaccine hesitancy.
Where now kind of the established position is that the left likes GMOs because they're pro-science.
You have the scientific establishment working with the federal government to silence science.
I'm Stephen Fairbanks, a writer and teacher from St. Louis, Missouri, and you're listening to the Vance Crow Podcast.
Welcome back to the podcast. I'm glad you're here. Well, we are going to have a man named Cam English on the podcast. I've known Cam since all the way back in my Monsanto days, and he has stayed in the science writing world where he's talking about pushing back on a lot of the popular narratives that get put out into the world. So we're going to get to that interview with Cam in just a moment. But first, I want to talk about something I'm really proud of. My team for the last 3 months put together a really amazing Legacy Interviews website. And the reason I say that is because when we started this business, we had really no idea what we were doing. I thought, like, hey, there are people that want me to record their stories. Let's just sit down and do that. But as we've started to do hundreds of these interviews, we've realized that the real value that we're creating is the ability for people to take the family history that they have and they know about and pass it on to future generations so those future generations know where they came from. So in times of anxiety and depression, they can look back on their family history knowing, hey, this is what my family has overcome to get where I'm at today. We have some really cool new videos on there. We have some blogs describing what we do and how we do it. And ultimately, if a legacy interview isn't for you, it just doesn't work for you to get to the studio, or maybe it's beyond your means right now, we're also putting up as much information as we can about how you can do your own interviews. Everything from setting the situation up to editing to even what kinds of questions do we ask. And we've started doing this because we believe that one of the most important things that you can do as a person contributing to the responsibilities of a family is to make sure you capture the stories of the people that came before you and you pass your own stories on to the future. Because this way people know where they came from, what they can go through, and what's possible. So if you're interested in learning more about Legacy Interviews, go to legacyinterviews.com. All right, without further ado, let's head to the interview with Cam English. Cam English, welcome to the podcast.
Hey, thank you so much, Vance. It's my pleasure.
Well, I was looking through your stuff over the weekend, and I'm proud to be with a guy that's been on, not only written hundreds and hundreds of articles, but also been on Dr. Phil and and pushing back on science narratives. I think you have a very interesting career. So maybe to begin, what do you do? How is it that you make a living? What have you been doing all these years?
Yeah, it's a great question. So I just discovered probably towards the end of high school that I love to write. And I did really well in classes where that was, you know, the focus was long form writing. And so in my early 20s, I just started doing it or asking people rather. You know, I think that's really good advice if anyone wants that, is if you want to do something, just email someone and say, hey, can I do this? And you'll be surprised how many times they'll say yes. But that led to internships, that led to part-time jobs, that led to freelance work. And then pretty soon after probably a decade or so, I got to a place where I had enough of a reputation where people would say, hey, come work for me, you know? And so I was in sales before that, which was a great career, but this is, you know, what I'm passionate about. So I said, bye, I'm, you know, done with cold calls and, you know, and so here I am. It's been this way for, you know, over a decade now doing this kind of work.
And what is the focus of most of your writing?
It's pretty diverse, but I'd say most of it is science policy and science communication. You know, a lot about, especially during the pandemic, a lot about vaccines and lockdowns and those sort of topics. But more broadly, a lot about agriculture. You know, as you well know, the GMO debate it's starting to wane down a little bit. But for a long time, that was a real controversial issue. Pesticide safety is always in the news. I'm talking about that almost constantly. So anything really that has an effect on public health and is controversial, chances are I've written at least one thing about it.
Yeah, about GMOs, this is an interesting topic because when I first started with Monsanto and we were pushing back against the anti-GMO narrative that was coming. There were all these symbols coming on, like that this product is non-GMO. There was like a lot of activism about being anti-Monsanto. But I would say, by and large, that pressure is almost completely gone. I mean, you can still find non-GMO labels, but it never crosses my radar in terms of like the public discourse. Is that what you're seeing?
I think so. I think the reason that's happening is because the groups and the activists that were pushing that narrative have sort of shifted focus to focus on glyphosate, as you know, a topic you're very familiar with. But they're focusing on pesticide safety as a way to attack conventional agriculture more generally. And so they're going through the courts. They're basically end running the regulatory process. So instead of making scientific arguments in academic journals, and working with agencies like the EPA, they publish a dubious study, or they publish something that's not even peer reviewed, and then they go into court with that, and all they have to do is convince 12 people that Corporation X deliberately harmed their customers, which is silly for a number of reasons that we can get into if you want. But they're attacking agriculture still. I just think they've changed the route of attack, because the GMO thing just started to fall flat, I think, because nothing happened, and people can have whatever views they want. And I don't knock organic agriculture in any way. That's not my approach, but they are still trying to attack conventional ag. They've just given up on that issue because there was no health impacts. I think that's basically what happened.
Yeah, there's like, I think a bunch of things that happen that are worth noting, and I haven't heard anybody really talk about this very much. I'm glad that we're on together, because one of the things that happened with GMOs is, because I would go out and do these talks, I would find out that people themselves often didn't have that many fears about GMOs. They were actually just like, I don't know, but I hear all these other people are worked up and upset about this. And so I feel like I would be irresponsible if I didn't also have suspicion about this. And what that took was a huge, hundreds of millions of dollars in PR and advertising being done to do the anti-GMO campaigns through groups like Greenpeace or the Environmental Working Group that always comes out with the Dirty Dozen. And people had this sense that these working groups were like, somehow like do-gooders, and they couldn't detect that these are actually really high-end PR firms that are just designed to create a bunch of fear and then be like, hey, we've got something that doesn't have this fearful thing in there that you should consider, like this Dannon product or whatever. Is that your take on it?
Yes, that's 100% correct. And it's sort of funny to me that a lot of these activists, if you see them on Twitter or X now, they've got the farm in the background and it's real scenic and beautiful, but they're headquartered in Manhattan or San Francisco, and they work in high-rise buildings, and they have law degrees, or they're public relations experts, like you said. But I think that goes to why they're so effective, is because they know the pain points to press on people. And especially, I'm a relatively new dad, so there's all of these emotions that have welled up over the last couple of years as you start to raise a child. And I totally appreciate on a whole nother level why, a scare campaign about pesticides or, lead in baby food or any of those issues, I get why that resonates with parents. And those groups do that over and over and over. That's the playbook, is just scare people as much as you can. And it's incredibly frustrating, but I think you're absolutely right about that.
Where does the money come from for these activist groups to do all this stuff?
It varies. I mean, in some cases, it's the organic food industry. And again, I want to stress, not the entirety of organic agriculture, but there's a subset of groups within that have really taken on that activist model. So they will fund some of this work, particularly in the anti-GMO era. That was a big, big source of funding. But a lot of it comes from foundations that were founded by billionaires who were either no longer alive or on their way out, so they've established these giant institutions with all of this money, and it goes to very specific political causes. And one of those, unfortunately, is attacking agriculture.
Yeah, there's been something that's happened, though, since, because I started at Monsanto, I think you were in the game about this time, like 2015, something like that. And like one of the things that I noticed is that, it used to be that a lot of the criticisms about GMOs and pesticides came from the left. And then I think there were a lot of people on the left that then started taking on the mantra of trust the science. And so now you have these two things where people are like, we're going to trust the science, the like establishment, and there are GMOs out there that scientists are telling us are okay. And so now it's a weird thing. My friends and I kind of call it the flippening, where now kind of the established position is that the left likes GMOs because they're pro-science. Do you see this?
I think it's one of these issues, and the vaccine issue is another one, where you have this weird, broad coalition of people that agree on almost nothing else, but they agree that, you know, big pharma is bad and big ag is bad, and the FDA and the EPA, right? There's this evil cohort that's working against all of our interests, you know? So they come together on that issue. But I noticed it, I want to say in like 2017, 18, because I did a podcast appearance. It's one of the biggest ones I had done at the time. And I was expecting a sympathetic audience because of the way, the opinions of the show or the show host that I was familiar with. But I got on and it was not like that. And it was good just as, you know, from a career perspective. But I think I realized that a lot of people who lean right or they identify as libertarians or whatever particular label they have, they see big things generally as bad, you know. So and the narrative changes. So on the left, it's, you know, big capitalism, big corporations are evil. On the right, the way that they approach it is to say, you know, the FDA has been paid off, and, you know, this is cronyism, this is rent seeking, and therefore, because of that, I don't have to trust anything that anybody says about crop biotechnology or pesticides.
Yeah, which makes it difficult because, like, you have to believe something, right? You have to have a model in your mind about, like, who is trustworthy, who are the people, what are their incentives, why are they doing what they're doing? And I think during all this cultural kind of chaotic moment that we're in, a lot of the base places, you know, like, oh, this the left, it follows these polls, the right follows these polls, they don't really make sense anymore. And I think you're watching... it's not going to be a pleasant thing as people's trust in institutions break down and then they give that trust to some other thing, right? You're going to trust something. So it's not just like, oh, our institutions have lost trust. Then what's picked up that trust?
It's all sorts of things that people turn to. You know, sometimes it's an influencer on social media, or sometimes it's their doctor. You know, they might have a physician that has a unique take on a topic, especially during COVID. You know, I saw that a lot. You know, people would say, I'm not getting this vaccine because my doctor told me that I don't need it or that there could be this risk. Or it could be a family member. You know, it's anyone that has built trust with you and maintained it. And this is something I've been pounding my desk about for like 4 or 5 years now, is that you have scientific institutions that are damaging their own reputations, often for political reasons, which is really, really concerning, you know. So they take up these causes that they shouldn't, or that they know they're wrong on. They have to know that they're wrong on, but they're doing it because it's the current thing. It's the fashionable. This is how you make everyone else know that you have the right opinions. And so that, I think, has been a very, very significant contributor to the declining trust in science and in public health or our political institutions more generally. And I don't think the people that you and I work with really, really appreciate that, because I see documents from like the American Academy of Pediatrics or one of these health associations, and they're just scratching their head publicly like, gee, we just can't convince anyone to, you know, get a vaccine or to feed their kids a nutritious diet or whatever. And they don't realize, it's like, well, yeah, because you endorsed every silly thing that occurred during the pandemic, or, you know, on the biological sex issue, right? You just come out and you say the craziest things. And then the average parent goes, there's no way I'm taking advice on anything from you. You know, it's just, in other words, if you live in the real world, it's readily apparent that this is a problem. But if you live in a bubble, you know, in DC or in Manhattan, like I said earlier, it's not clear to you because you're not interacting with the people that you're giving advice to. And I think that's a real problem.
Yeah, I think that's definitely true. The big houses where all this information is getting pumped out is either in DC or in New York. And one of the reasons that this all occurs is because you have an organization, like let's say doctors, they want to be doing medical work. They want to be seeing patients. They want to be building their practices. They want to be, so they do what all good practices do. They create a group of people that they say, hey, we're going to take a little bit of our money and we're going to put it towards this group that's going to do lobbying for us. They're going to make sure our professional accreditations are strong and that we stay at the top of our field. And ultimately, from my perspective, a lot of that bureaucracy that they set up becomes ultimately like a part of the larger web of bureaucratic institutions where they're swapping people in and out that are not from the medical field, but instead from the bureaucratic field. And as you've done that, you've created this lattice work where all of the professional organizations deep inside of their institutional memory are the things that have been created by the bureaucrats that were in there, people that want to take positions on stuff that does not fit the professional definition. And you start having these doctors groups take positions that are totally insane because their communications people, their bureaucrat people are the ones supporting it. And then they don't even know where their group is gone, right? They like, it's just happened so deeply that the it's almost difficult for them to detect how it happened.
Yeah, it's a real problem. There's two things broadly that I think are the issue. The first is that all of these institutions want to fit in, and that makes perfect sense, right? As you know, you're trying to maintain your reputation with society more generally, and so you're going to say the things, and we all do this to a certain extent, you're going to say the things that people expect you to say, and then you're going to say the things that help you avoid controversy. You know, and this is true, and you can relate to this. This is true in big corporations. It's true in trade groups. It's true in nonprofits. Most people in most organizations, they want to focus on the thing that they do, right? So the best way that they've come up with, and I think this is mistaken, but the way they come up with this is we're just going to avoid controversy. So if somebody attacks us for one reason or another, we'll just try to sweep it under the rug, or we'll try to make peace with them, and then we get back to what we want to do. And again, I get that, especially if you're in medicine, you, as you said, you want to take care of sick people. You want to make people better. You don't want to spend all your time, you know, having Twitter debates with, you know, whomever is on the other side. So I understand that. But I think you have to change how you communicate in some cases. And then broadly, this is having a very, very serious impact because, you know, these groups come out and they say, you know, let's put kids on drugs that are totally untested for the purpose we're using, right? And then everyone just goes, yes, of course. Of course. It's the new civil rights movement. It's like, no, this is absurd, right? This you wouldn't accept this on any other scientific issue, right? But because of the political climate, this is allowed, not only allowed, but it's celebrated in the sectors of society that should be pumping the brakes.
Well, and then to your point, like if you start taking these, you know, positions that are clearly politically motivated, it makes rational sense that the people that you were originally connecting with would say, wait a second, I can very clearly spot where you jumped off the rails from your like scientific knowledge, what you have an expertise in, into your political ideology. And then like if somebody doesn't then deny that they have authority on the other subjects, they're being obtuse, right? Because you like if you just watch somebody make this terrible mistake and you say, well, okay, I'm going to just turn the page over on their bad take on this one and then accept theirs on how they feel about, you know, other vaccines or about smoking or about drugs or about the way to live your life, like you've just given over the credibility that you had in order to make, you know, stay in the political class.
Yeah, it's really troubling. And I started with the assumption that, you know, if we just pointed this out enough, then people would right their ship and then they would start to go, maybe I shouldn't talk about this issue. For one, it's outside of my expertise, but it's also, it's a Molotov cocktail, right? It's going to torch my credibility with the people I need to convince. But I think it's more likely that they have their own political opinions and their own biases, and those are increasingly bleeding through. And you see this everywhere. It's not a left thing. It's not a right thing. It's becoming more common for people to come up and say, you know, I'm a this or that, and I believe this and this, and if you don't like it, then you're evil, you know? And so in that climate, it's harder for people to step back and say, oh, let me rethink what I said here, you know? And again, it's a very human trait to not want to say you were wrong. I get that. And I've been there too. But it's important. because if you don't, right, you're going to lose your credibility.
Well, you've been in an interesting position because I think for from the outside, you'd say, hey, he's a science writer. He's going to be able to get ostensibly on the side of the left or the side of the people that are participating in science orthodoxy. But the way that you and I got in touch just recently was that you were flagging an article about like, hey, wait a second. There was a bunch of censorship done by the left about scientific stuff that we should be able to talk about. I can't imagine that makes you popular among the establishment.
Yeah, I don't care. I just, it does. And I mean, I'm hardly a celebrity. Don't get me wrong. Like I don't think of myself that way, but nevertheless, if it comes down to it, I'll just go dig ditches for a living. I'm not going to say something or write something I don't believe, just to appease whoever, that's silly to me. So yes, to your point, that article was about, it was more about the scientific community's response to what was going on. But yeah, the Biden administration was very clearly censoring content on social media that they had deemed mis or disinformation. And I can't stand those terms, by the way, but, they say this post is bad, or this account needs to be deplatformed, or this tweet needs to be, you need to throttle this down. We don't want as many people seeing this. And then they were threatening consequences, so that you have these, and a lot of this came out in discovery in the Missouri v. Biden lawsuit that's on its way to the Supreme Court in the next little while here. You have White House staffers talking to people at Twitter and Facebook, and they're saying, you're not doing enough to control misinformation. And there's a lot of concern here at the White House. And I mean, at the highest levels, wink, wink, right? So like the implication is the president himself is really, really irritated with what you're doing here, and then other places they'll say, we're considering our options internally, right? Like if someone says that to you and they have authority over you, what does that mean? Well, that means, do what I want or there's going to be consequences. And then of course, publicly the whole time, during the campaign, during the Biden-Harris campaign, and then once the administration took office, they were saying publicly, we're going to reform Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, which gives the platforms immunity for most of the third-party content on their platforms. And they were talking about antitrust litigation, and this is in the administration itself, but in Congress too. You have people saying, we're going to break up your company and we're going to, you're not doing enough to silence this anti-vaccine misinformation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? So if you are an executive at Twitter or Facebook, like, what are you going to take from that? Like, you're going to go to war with the federal government on this? Probably not. To the point we made just a little while ago, it's easier to comply. And that's what happened. So that's the starting point for the story, my long-winded summary of the issue.
Well, this is great. I mean, keep going. So as you've been able to point out, hey, clearly there was censorship going on. And ostensibly what it was information that they were saying we don't want to get out that later ended up ultimately not being as bad information as you thought. So it was like now the establishment is protecting a narrative that proved to be, it's just crazy. So what's going on now that you're able to point out, hey, this is like obvious censorship?
Again, the reaction from scientists has been alarming to me, So in the article, I was responding to two of my colleagues at the American Council on Science and Health, who are great. They do a lot of great work. But on this issue, I just thought they were mistaken because they're taking an argument that's very common. They'll say, well, this was voluntary. The social media companies complied. And then they go on and they say, well, we need experts monitoring what goes on Facebook and Twitter because we want people to get good information, right? We want people to get a vaccine based on the best available science. And that's true in the abstract, and I agree with it, of course. But as I pointed out in the article, you had people saying, like working for, like a nonprofit that's funded by the government, right? They're going to Twitter and they're flagging content and they're saying, this is true, but it's being misinterpreted, right? So we don't want people to read this too frequently because it might inspire vaccine hesitancy. And this isn't like, Joe's blog, deep in the internet. This is like a New York Times story about the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, for example, And you have these busybodies. It just, these people drive me insane. The mindset that motivates somebody to do this kind of work, where you're like, I'm going to dictate what you may read on Twitter. It's like, who, you know, I don't know you. I didn't, you know, it's just silly. But in any case, they're taking it.
But you can imagine like the righteous younger mind, or the mind that's saying like, oh, we, like all those other people are bad and they're being misled by bad people, so we need to have the opposite thing. And, you know, I've got to go out and do my part to protect it. I mean, I can very clearly see how somebody can get the righteousness bug and then that allow them to do horrible, horrific things.
Well, yeah, but imagine, well, no, you don't have to imagine. It's so incredibly condescending, you know, to look at the average person and say, you know, you vote, you pay taxes, you raise kids, but you're too dumb to understand a New York Times article. You know, I just, that's never stated outright, but that's the clear assumption behind a movement or a campaign like this, is that, you know, you need me, you need your benevolent overlord to explain to you what you should do, and you can't get any other opinion because you're stupid, you know. So that to me is wild. But I think it brings up another important point, which is that, you know, when these people make their case to the public, they don't say, we're going to kick some factual information off of Twitter, or we're going to kick this scientist off Twitter. What they say is, there's harmful disinformation out there. There's people deliberately lying to you for profit or for ideological reasons, and we're going to silence them. But then when you get into discovery in a lawsuit like this, or you look at the Twitter files that were released by Matt Taibbi after Elon Musk bought Twitter, you know, you see very clearly it wasn't just false information. It was true information, and it was information about policy, right? So they started flagging content related to vaccine mandates, not vaccine safety, but, you know, mandates themselves, and research related to breakthrough infections, and research related to natural immunity. So in other words, you you have the scientific establishment working with the federal government to silence science. You know, it's absurd. It's like, it seems so self-evident that it's crazy that you have to make that argument today to people, to say you don't see the problem with the federal government coming in and cutting off one half of the discussion. You know, it creates so much confusion, right? Not only are you cutting off information, but you're silencing people. You're like, trust scientists, just not these ones.
I think what makes your point a lot more real to me is that it's very easy to come on and be like, everything that they're telling you is a lie, they're wrong, I'm going to tell you about the secret truth that I've found and discovered. But you're actually in a very unusual position, in that I read an article that you wrote, I don't know, not that long ago, that was like, hey, let me explain to you how safe the vaccine is. So this is coming from a guy that is willing to stand on the side of like, hey, the vaccine had positive benefits and it was designed in this way and the downsides are this way, and yet I'm still pissed off that you are choosing which scientists to believe. So maybe you could clarify your position on kind of what the vaccine is, and then kind of tie that into like how you're kind of standing on an island because there's not many people doing what you're doing.
Yeah, it's a problem from time to time, but I got the COVID shots. I got the primary doses. I ended up not getting boosters because it became clear that people in my age cohort weren't really at risk, you know? And then as time went on, the vaccines got less and less effective at controlling transmission, and then in some cases controlling, you know, severe disease that people were getting. So as a result of that, I reached a point where I said, you know, I'm good. You know, I got the vaccines. There's a chance I've probably been infected and I just didn't know it, because, you know, it's basically endemic at this point, I think, is what people are saying, experts are saying. So I don't have any problem with the COVID vaccine or any vaccine generally. You know, I have a young son. He's got all the shots he's supposed to have. I have a young daughter on the way. She's going to get her vaccines, you know. But I think my primary concern is that when you mandate something, you immediately send off an alarm in someone's head. You know, it's like, why do you need to force me to do this? And again, you're a parent. You understand this very, very well, right? What's the first thing a kid's going to do if you say, don't do that, right? They're going to go do that, right? And that doesn't change as we age, right? We get more sophisticated in the way we think and so on. But if, you know, if particularly a politician you don't like gets on TV and they say, you're going to do this or you're going to lose your job, you know, like coming out of the pandemic, or I guess it was the middle of the pandemic at that point, you know, people are really strapped already because you have these lockdowns and there's all of these other cultural issues that are in play. That's just chaos. And then, you know, the government comes out and says, you're going to do this or you're fired. Right. I mean, like, I can't think of a worse way to sell a vaccine to somebody, you know. And again, you've worked in science communication a long time. We both know a lot of the same people. They'll all tell you, you don't destroy somebody's values in the process of trying to win them over. Right. You're supposed to appeal to what they're concerned about. And that was all thrown out during the pandemic. You know, stay in your house, of course, unless you want to go to this protest. That's perfectly acceptable. Otherwise, stay in your house. This is a deadly virus, you know. And that happened over and over again. It happened with masking. It happened with all sorts of policies. And, you know, again, people look at that and they go, why am I going to trust anything that you're saying? So that in a roundabout way, that was my motivation for all of those stories, because I wrote a bunch about vaccine mandates. I wrote a bunch about masking. And that was always my central theme, was you are eroding the public's trust in you. And I don't understand how you can't see this. Stop doing this. Stop doing this. Stop doing, you know. So that's why I've continued to hit on that theme. And you're seeing the results. You know, the polls show very clearly that people are losing trust in what scientists say.
Yeah, and like it's an odd thing that somebody would sit during hey, what are we going to do about this problem? That they would be like, let's just tell them they're not allowed to do anything else. Because the only person that works on is the person that's like, either I already agree with what's being said here, or I'm extremely compliant. Every other person, every other personality type, even people that are not disagreeable, but the mama bear that's like, wait, I'd be fine if you were just forcing me, but now you're forcing my child. And like, I don't ever actually see, I'm kind of torn in these two thoughts, because on the one hand, I don't see a way back. Like, I don't actually understand how you could get the idea that the people in power also represent science accurately. But then on the other hand, I also totally believe that given enough propaganda, a vast swath of the population will forget what they just learned, you know, a year ago or 2 years ago, and make the exact same mistakes again.
It could be. I don't predict the future. I don't know. I think what has probably happened is there's enough of a contingent of people that aren't going to believe the you know, the sanctified official experts the next time this, hopefully this never happens, and again, in our lifetimes, but the next time there's a public health crisis, there's enough people that have been turned that are saying, I'm not going to go along with this, right? And maybe next time the advice is good and people aren't going to follow it, you know. And when that happens, right, no one's going to go, gee, you know, we really messed this up the last time, our bad, right? They're going to blame it on those people, you know, all those disinformation dozen, right? The RFK Jr.'s at it again. It's like, he's bad in many ways. And I'm very frustrated with a lot of the things he says and the litigation he's involved in. But his reach is limited. You know, his name's well known, but if you go up to the average person in the grocery store, they don't know what he thinks about vaccines or pesticides or whatever, right? But they heard Dr. Tony Fauci on TV day after day for 3 years. And they heard the president, and they heard his press secretaries, and they heard this scientist, and they saw, you know, again, the American Academy of Pediatrics come out and say, we need gun control. And, you know, we need to affirm children as they want to transition, you know, like they hear all this stuff, and they're getting it constantly, right? Deliberately so. And then we're ignoring the impact of that. And we're like, yeah, it's this RFK guy, or it's Joe Mercola, or it's, you know, it's like, yeah, these guys are bad, but the problem is clearly more complex than.
Yeah. So you mentioned RFK, and in the world of ag, like, he is a person that, like, it's just an interesting thing. When I hear him describing who he is, where he came from, people will say, oh, he's the guy that cleaned up the Hudson River. Is that your take on RFK? Where are you at with the work he's done?
It's generally bad, you know, and because as a very typical example, he was heavily involved in the glyphosate litigation. And that's, we don't have to rehash the argument, but most of your audience knows this chemistry is perfectly safe as it's used. It's been studied to death. You know, it's 10,000 different studies, different study designs from researchers all over the world. It's like, if there's any issue that we could go, yeah, you know, let's not worry about this. Let's worry about any other of the dozens of public health issues we have. But nevertheless, he worked with the other lawyers who were responsible for that multi-district litigation. And, you know, right, took billions of dollars from a company that didn't do anything wrong and under false pretenses, you know. So I generally have a low view of him, but I understand why he's able to appeal to people, especially as we've been talking about, they're fed up with what they've been told from the people that are in power, you know. So that's another risk, is they turn to people like RFK because he's the savior figure, right? I've got this figured out. Come listen to what I have to say.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. He's a part of the kind of larger class action lawsuit world that people are astonished when they find out how it works. So there's a bunch of different ways this works, and this is just an outsider's perspective. But there are, for example, conventions. You go to Las Vegas and you go to a giant convention hall, and as you walk up and down, just like at an agri show, you'd see a bunch of tractors or people selling different types of farm insurance or whatever you would sell at an agri show. Now you have these same things, but they're for class action attorneys. And a lot of these people are setting up booths and putting on presentations to be like, look, we found that there's a study that shows that, for example, there's asbestos in this type of body powder. And so what we're gonna do is line up investors that wanna go to court over this. And we'll take your investment money and we'll turn it into billboards and late night television shows and just pepper the world with nice attorneys asking people, have you been harmed in this very specific way? Well, if you have, call this number. So then they collect all these people that want to go into a lawsuit. Then they go to the company and they say, hey, do you want to fight this or do you want to just settle it? And hopefully from the lawsuit's standpoint, they need to get more money out of it than what they took in as investment, so they know what their costs are. And then they go to court. And even if we take it away from Johnson or from the glyphosate stuff that happened with Monsanto, my very favorite product in the whole world, Gold Bond, is now being produced without talcum powder because they're so afraid of being sued that their talcum powder had, you know, some amount of asbestos in it. And meanwhile, there's products being taken off and other people that won these either lawsuits or settlements. And those lawyers are RFK. That was his business model.
Yeah, well, I'm out here in California where a lot of this litigation gets filed because you have the Ninth Circuit, the federal circuit that is most sympathetic. But in San Francisco, you have juries that are very, very friendly to this, I call it the Aaron Brockovich story, right? There's bad corporations, they're lying to you, they want to make you sick so they can make money. That story sells well out here. And we have a law called Proposition 65 out here, which I'm sure a lot of your listeners are familiar with. But essentially, it regulates certain chemicals in the state of California, right? And so if you come out here, you'll see signs everywhere. It says, you know, this restaurant uses a chemical or an ingredient that's known to the state of California to cause cancer, blah, 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 blah. And it's so corrupt that you have the plaintiffs' law firms and the defense law firms. They will host conferences like the one you're talking about. They will host conferences where they work together and they have industry trade groups come in and they have the activist groups that file Prop 65 lawsuits come in. And they all work together to basically come up with settlements, right? Because the plaintiffs, they just sue anyone that they can think of. And the law is very, very friendly to that. It was established that way. And then the defense attorneys realize that, well, we can make more money if we just come to a settlement with these other guys. So let's have a conference and we'll all just, you know. So it's like the game is so seriously and severely rigged that you have businesses, they will just join trade groups that are part of settlements, that are part of Prop 65 settlements, where they join, they pay a fee, and that's their contribution to the settlement, and then they get to do business without fear of more lawsuits. You know, it's like the whole thing is just a waste of time and resources.
Yeah, it's this wild, like, parasitic system, right, where eventually the corporations say, it's just easier for us to go along with it in this way. And so you have people behind the scenes that aren't building anything. They're not creating anything. They're not making the world safer. But they are, like, poking these corporations. And they do have some ambivalence about this because, you know, if you've ever stood outside the walls of a major corporation, you realize, like, this corporation can marshal together resources that I cannot possibly do on my own. And so you need to have a legal system that allows for the little guy to be able to push back on a corporation that has millions or billions of dollars to be able to dedicate to fighting off your lawsuit or your complaint. But on the other hand, when you open up this crack, you expose part of your flank to being able to be necrotic and have parasites all over it. And it really causes a lot of problems that are probably more important than my gold bond one, but that's the one I'm mad about in the middle of summer when I chafe because they can't use talcum powder. You laugh. Yeah. I'm pissed about this.
I know what you're feeling, you know, like with the non-GMO stuff. I go to the grocery store and I'll buy my son these little vegetable pouches, and it's a great way to get him to eat vegetables, but they all have that stupid butterfly, you know, non-GMO project certified, and I have to pay an extra $1.25 for each one, you know. So I get it, right? I mean, all of this litigation, all of this, you know, these scare tactics that are employed against big companies primarily, they have real consequences, you know. And sometimes it's subtle, right? Sometimes it's just a slight increase in food prices, or maybe it's a product that you have a harder time getting. Or, you know, sometimes it's more severe. And that, I think, is the problem, is that people don't see until it's too late. It's like, you know, you cheerlead these lawyers right now and these plaintiffs because they're fighting the man. And, you know, everyone loves that underdog story. But if we don't get this under control, there could come a time when our agricultural system is really threatened because you're pulling so many chemistries off the market, or you're so restricting, you know, the amount of greenhouse emissions that can come from agriculture, that it's
yeah, hard. I don't think it's just a threat. I think it is absolutely and categorically changing modern agriculture. And, you know, if you listen to one of my latest podcast guests, John Kemp, he would say, hey, probably good that we change away from this large petro ag chemical system. But I will say that it would be there have been almost no chemistries developed by large corporations in the last 15 to 20 years. And it's because they know the regulatory burden to bring a new chemistry, a new way of saying, hey, we have been able to kill that weed without killing the crops or without, you know, degrading the soil in some important way. And so they don't want to even bring it into the regulatory world, which means there's no R&D going in there. So we have this sort of scientific dark era where the threat of litigation is so strong that it keeps people from trying new things. And so what we end up doing is wearing out the things that we do have available to us instead of continuing to move along that path of developing new ones.
Yeah, I forget the exact figures, but it's in the hundreds of millions of dollars, and it's probably 10 years of R&D to get a new chemistry on the market or a new crop trait or whatever. And that's, you know, I mean, you need regulations in place to protect public health and make sure that you're not introducing something that's harmful. But does it cost, you know, $600 million to do that? I have my doubts. You know, if you go to the EPA's website, they have a pesticide registration manual. And I've joked on my own podcast, if you ever have trouble sleeping, just crack this thing open. I promise you'll conk right out, because it's 25 chapters. It's absurdly long. It's boring and technical. But that's what every registrant has to go through in order to get anything approved through EPA, you know? And again, this is more economics than it is science, but that's one of the unseen impacts that people never realize they're losing, right? It's resources wasted on regulatory nonsense instead of actually developing product.
Yeah, and what I've heard from people in the ag industry is that the next big movement is towards the Endangered Species Act. So like they've clamped down on the EPA and the ability to bring new products to market. But now how, what can they use that's already there that can start to restrict the use of things that exist? And one of the ways that they're starting to see the activist move is towards saying, hey, we need to revisit the Endangered Species Act. We haven't put a new animal on it in, you know, 30, 40 years, some 1970s or 80s. So what we should do is start opening it up and seeing, are there any voles or any ground owls or any, you know, insects that are getting harmed by these chemicals that are now, we can put them on the Endangered Species Act. And now you have to really change the way you apply these chemicals or what, where they're appropriate. And so it seems like this is the temperature is going to get turned up even more in the next few years.
Yeah, it could be. I'm not as familiar with the trends with the ESA. I know that one of the things they will do is they will go into that law and they will find, you know, some obscure regulation that, like, when you're testing a pesticide, you have to, you know, you have to do this dance and then you have to wear this hat, you know. And if the company doesn't wear this hat when they do the test, then they sue them or they sue EPA. And then they say, you didn't make them wear this hat when they were testing their pesticide. Therefore, this can't go to market. And then it gets clogged up in federal court for 10 years, you know. So it's, that's the thing that concerns me, is that what they say publicly, like these anti-pesticide groups, they'll say, you know, this causes cancer, or this will give your kid autism, or, you know, it causes birth defects. But when they go argue in federal court, what they say is, you know, you forgot to cross a T at line 127, you know. So it's like these very technical, you know, obtuse arguments, and they work because, you know, court is court, but it you know, has very serious consequences for everybody.
So speaking of government regulation, there, you have been pointing out something very interesting. I see this being pointed out in the UK, but very few people talking about it in the US, which is about how the government has really come out very strongly against vaping, when it's been shown pretty conclusively to help people get off of straight up smoking tobacco. So what have you discovered there? What's going on there that most people don't know about?
Yeah, it's a great topic. Well, let me say, full disclosure, I write about this professionally and explicitly. My goal is to get the FDA to change its insane policies. So just want to be clear about that. But the basic problem is this technology really exploded onto the market in the mid-2000s. And they started with devices that looked like little cigarettes, but they weren't. They just contained nicotine in a liquid, in a solution that's vaporized. The research has shown very clearly, over and over again, really well-designed studies and reviews by, like, the Cochrane Collaboration, which is a very respected scientific body, have shown over and over these products are, they carry a fraction of the risk of smoking. And they help smokers quit because you can maintain that hand-to-mouth habit that is really a significant part of the addiction. It contains nicotine, which on its own is basically a mild stimulant. It really can't harm you in the doses that you'd find in a typical vaping device. Nevertheless, instead of embracing this technology and encouraging people to use it, the FDA, again, influenced by a whole cohort of different set of public health activist groups, is crushing the vaping industry. So, you know, I mean, you have an audience that's probably very familiar with these different dynamics, but it's not a coincidence that the only devices you can technically legally buy right now are sold by big tobacco companies, and you can only buy them in tobacco flavor and everything else. The FDA at this point has reviewed, I want to say, 20 million different product applications, and all of them except 23 devices and liquids have been approved. So, you know, you have these products, and the FDA, by the way, knows that these products that they're banning are more popular because they did an internal study that was FOIA'd and released publicly. And it's very clear, right? They know that the flavored products that they're all concerned about are actually very popular with adults. We know from really good data that teen vaping is very low, and so is teen smoking, you know? So that's a non-issue as far as public health is concerned. But nevertheless, that is being used as the bludgeon that the federal government is destroying this industry with. And it's tragic. You know, I mean, the public health consequences of having a viable alternative to cigarettes, and you are denying that to many smokers, you know, You're telling them there's health risk in this thing that could save their lives. That's tragic on its own. But then this industry, it's really cool in that it's mostly small and mid-sized manufacturers and little shops that are dedicated to selling these products. And most of these people, they quit smoking this way. And now their whole life's work is to help other people do it the same way. You know, so it's a very, it was a growing, exciting industry. And it has been almost completely eliminated by the federal bureaucrats that we were talking about earlier and by these billionaire funded activist groups.
Yeah, what's the mechanism there? What is driving people to want to ban this if it's so obviously like better than the alternative?
You know, it's hard to say. I think what happened is vaping really disrupted the anti-smoking operation, right? Because there was an activism model that groups like Campaign for Tobacco-Free Kids followed, which is big bad tobacco companies make cigarettes. We chastise them for making cigarettes. Then we tax cigarettes. Then we get cigarette money to attack them again for making cigarettes. Then we collect more taxes, right? And then over time, the plan was we're going to reduce smoking that way. You know, we're just effectively going to make it socially unacceptable to smoke cigarettes. And that worked to some extent. That did reduce smoking in the 90s and in the early 2000s. But then vaping comes along, and for that remaining 30 million people that have not quit yet, this is an easy way to do it. You know, it's like I can still enjoy this habit without the harm. And there's interesting research on this. I can actually step down my nicotine dependence with one of these devices. So in other words, if you completely solve the problem, then there's no money to be made in solving the problem. You know what I'm saying here? So
yeah, man, that's dark. That's dark.
Yes, I know it is. I know it is. And no one's going to come out and say, you know, we want people to keep smoking so we can, you know, keep our budgets up, right? No one's going to say that. But if you look at their actions, the actions of these different groups, that seems to me to be the only explanation. You know, so for example, California was going to pass a law, I think it was last year, that would have prohibited cigarette sales to anyone born after 2007, which is how I know I'm getting old, by the way. But they were going to pass this law and say if you're born after 2007, you can't buy cigarettes. Without exception, every major anti-tobacco group opposed that law. And they said, you know, this is the right time for this. You know, we need to focus on flavored tobacco products, right? They had some silly excuse. But, you know, it's like, well, you, in many cases, get public money to eliminate tobacco use. And this is prime real estate, right? This is California. They want to stop young people from buying cigarettes. And you were like, you know, well, I don't know. It's a bad time for that, right? So, and I mean, the economics of it make it clear is that, well, this is a threat to your activism model. I think that's what it is.
Well, another thing that you've been standing up for, which I think is not altogether all that popular, is that you're saying, hey, wait a second on these painkiller, like the people that are saying, oh, Oxycontin is just the worst thing to ever happen. And there's been multi-part series on Netflix about, you know, who is generating all this money from it. So it's interesting to me that you are in these spaces. But what's your take on what's going on with Oxycontin and the people trying to get rid of it?
Yeah, it's a tragedy what's happening, because people are being denied medication that they need, and they're killing themselves because they'd rather die than live in excruciating pain. And there's all sorts of cases like this, but there's been I want to say hundreds of thousands of deaths related to the fentanyl epidemic, because people either commit suicide or they're denied access to legal opioids. So they go to the street to get them and they overdose, because that stuff's highly dangerous, as people know, or they commit suicide, or they just live in excruciating pain. And just to one quick story to show how absurd this is, that woman who I co-host my podcast with, Dr. Liza Dunn's emergency medicine physician, and
she's been a guest on the podcast. Yeah,
yeah, Yeah, she's awesome. I love working with her. But she told me a story once about a patient who had overdosed on Percocet, who came into the ER, and it turned out she had metastatic cancer, and she was in so much pain that she took too much of the medicine too quickly. And so the doctor who was in the ER at the time wrote a referral to go see Liza for an addiction consult. And Liza met the woman and, you know, got a sense of her case and said, well, she's terminal. She's gonna die in weeks or months. You know, she doesn't need an addiction consult. She needs you to adjust the medication so she can live in relative comfort, you know, for the little bit of time she has left, you know? So that's the absurd level we've gotten to. Again, this is driven largely by CDC guidance, which is, again, is a theme here, right? It's driven by the DEA. And people are suffering for this. And the evidence is very clear. There's a lot of really good experts speaking up on this. My colleague, Dr. Josh Bloom, at the American Council on Science and Health, is a real, real expert on this. But it's a tragedy. And the thing that I wrote, the story about the Netflix, is that they are just lying to people because they're trying to tell a story. You know, so there's points in that show where there's what happened and then there's how they twisted the story to make it fit the narrative that they wanted to sell. And they talk about this, you know, like every episode starts with a disclaimer. And this was so disingenuous to me. They would have the mother or father of a drug addict who had died from opioids or from, you know, heroin or whatever. And they would say, you know, certain parts of this show, certain names and places and dates and actual events have been changed for dramatic effect. But what hasn't changed is my daughter's story. And then they'd hold up a picture and, you know, they'd be like, this is Sally and she died. And right. So in other words, they're using, I can't imagine what it's like to lose a child, but they're using this unbearable pain for people to justify lying in their show. Because what they're saying is, yes, we changed a lot of stuff, but people died. And here's Sally's mom. So, you know, it's like, it's a weird way to say, yeah, we changed things and here's the disclaimer, but also, you know, we're really telling the truth. It's just outrageous.
So you write on all these different topics. You've been all over the board, right? From vaping to Oxy to COVID, you know, censorship. What are you looking out on the horizon and saying, this is a subject area I'm going to start approaching because it's not being covered enough?
Yeah. I enjoy controversy, so I'm going to start writing a little bit more about the effects of pornography. I wrote the first story I have ever about that just a couple weeks ago, but NPR had published a story warning about this little subculture of men online who are banding together and they're giving up porn. And they're teaching each other, you know, this is bad. Here's why you need to stop. Here's how you stop. It's in so many ways, it's like a 12-step program without the label, but it's people coaching each other through giving up porn. And NPR's fear of this was not, or their response wasn't like, well, that's good. That's probably, you know, if that helps them, then great. Their response was, well, this is a pipeline to radical right-wing politics. You know, it's like, that's just so silly. Right. And so I went through in that story and I looked at the research, and there's a lot of research that's been done that shows, for men and women, but especially for men, there's a lot of serious or potentially serious, cause not everyone's the same, but there's a lot of potentially serious impacts from, you know, frequent porn use over the years. So you have people reporting erectile dysfunction, or they're reporting, you know, dissatisfaction in their marriage, or, you know, in some cases, domestic violence. I mean, there's all sorts of problems connected to this. And the causal link isn't always clear. So don't get me wrong here. I'm not saying if someone watches porn, they're going to beat up their wife. That's not what I'm saying. But there are things that need to be explored, and there's a lot of research on it. And the reaction from the press has been, you know, well, you should keep watching it, I guess, so you don't become too ultra conservative. You know, it's just a silly kind of a narrative. But I'm going to keep writing about that because I think it's an overlooked issue.
Yeah. Why is kind of a difficult question here, but it is striking to me that because I saw your article or the conversation you had, the podcast about the NPR article. why do you think NPR is coming out on that side of it? Is it like more of an ideological belief? They're trying to preserve something? What do you think?
There's no firm answers. So I'm only speculating here. But what I suspect is that if you acknowledge that there is some harm from porn, well, then you have to say, well, why is it harmful? You know? And then you get into a place very quickly where you're starting to question some of what our culture says about sexuality. And so I think that makes reporters at NPR very uncomfortable, you know? So instead of, you know, addressing those questions, what they do is they say, well, you know, this is the new alt-right. It's just so silly, you know, because it's like most men are not doing that, right? They go to these chat rooms or they go to these subreddits because they're like, you know, I'm 29 and I'm experiencing symptoms of erectile dysfunction. What's going on, right? That's unheard of at that age, you know? So it's a real problem for people. And their response to it is, you know, this is right. You leaving is bad. And I think that's what's alarming, but basically I think that's what it is. And again, just speculation. But that's what it comes down to, I think, is, you know, we don't want to talk openly about some of the harms that could come from our sexual proclivities, basically.
Well, that will be an interesting path to go down. I definitely see that happening out in the world, like more and more podcasts talking openly about it, people talking about it. I just happened to catch a podcast called Timcast in Real Life, and they ended up talking with people that had done a big investigation into how the porn industry works. And you start being like, man, I had no idea about how complicated this was, how much money there is. And I think that you're probably right on the beginning of that wave, because I think it's going to get a lot bigger.
Yep, we're going to keep writing about it. But thank you for having me. This was a great conversation.
Yeah, man. Cam, thank you so much for coming on. If people wanted to read more about what you're doing and connect with you, where could they go?
You can follow me on Twitter or X, whatever it's called. It's just at Cam J English. So all my writing's there. You can follow me there. My website is CameronJEnglish.net. Sign up for my newsletter. I don't send out frequent updates, so I won't spam you. But if you want to get updates on my writing, go to the website. And then, of course, acsh.org is the organization.
Well, Cameron English, thank you so much for coming on.